Bismillah, walhamdulillah, and Allah's mercy and blessings be upon His messengers and on the righteous people until the day of judgment. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, and welcome to part 2 from Ad-Dajjal, where we left with the incident where the messenger of Allah told the companions about the story of Tamim Ad-Dari, who met Ad-Dajjal and spoke to him. And but before carry on with this second part, there is one thing, or a couple of things actually, that I want to clear out right on. First, I don't want you to think that I am sitting here and just contradicting or just looking for defects in anything that is out there. That's not my goal at all. But my goal is that on Judgment Day, when we face Allah for accountability, and knowing that the Quran will be the only book of authority on Judgment Day, because on Judgment Day, whatever you're going to be telling Allah is, I read this in Al-Quran, and this is how I understood it, and this is how I apply it. We cannot say to Allah that I applied something because the hadith in Bukhari says so, and the Quran doesn't say that. Then you would need to prove to Allah that you got it from Him, and it is impossible. And that's why, as far as I am concerned, and this is where I will die on, and that is, the Quran is the only authority in Islam. It is the book of guidance to both mankind and the jinn altogether, and is also a book of guidance to the believers. Allah has countless times praised the Quran from within the Quran, because no other human can praise the Quran as Allah does, because the Quran simply is the spoken words of Allah. It is Allah's words. We speak them out loudly, but they are Allah's words. It's just like reading an email loudly. Allah has described the Quran as the guide to Allah's pleasure, and He did that within the Quran. So the authority of the Quran is within the Quran by Allah. Allah has extensively and really deeply warned us against not following the Quran or following something else, be that the Bible or any other doctrines or any other sayings, even of humans. And also He has mentioned that the Quran shall have a total exclusivity on Judgment Day. And by exclusivity, I mean that on Judgment Day, the only book by which Allah will judge us will be the Quran, and the Quran all alone. There won't be any books of hadith, there won't be any sayings of the scholars, there won't be any school of thoughts, nothing of that. So much so that on Judgment Day, our Prophet Muhammad will stand in one side with the Quran with him, and his entire ummah, the believers, from the very first one to believe in Muhammad and the Quran and what Allah has sent, to the last man. And then He will point at us and each one of us to a certain degree, and He will say, Ya Rabbi, inna qawmi takhadu hadha al-Qur'an majura. My Lord, my God, my people have taken this Qur'an as abandoned. Not only have we abandoned, but we deliberately abandoned the Qur'an. So the danger is there, and this book will have the exclusivity on Judgment Day. So on Judgment Day, it's going to be what you, and you put 1,000 lines under the word you, what you have learned from the Quran, how you implement it. On Judgment Day, you cannot tell Allah, you will not be able to say to Allah that I did this because the hadith or sunnah or scholars or school of thoughts or my brother or said, told me to do that, because the answer will be just as Allah would expect from you, that you have read the Quran, understood the message from the Quran, applied. It's Allah, you see, you cannot say, Ya Allah, I did this because you said in the Quran, and somebody else told me that, and I changed my mind, and I went for what this sheikh said. On Judgment Day, you are expected to say, Ya Allah, I did this because you said this in the Quran, and when I studied the Quran, I understood from what you said this and this, and based on that understanding of mine, yours, I did this. You will not, see, you will do everything in your powers to avoid on Judgment Day putting any other text before the Quran. You see, if you lived in Australia and you drive and you got your license, the driving license from Australia, and then one day you mess up By which law will the Australian government fine you? Is it by the Australian law and the highway code? Or will they, for example, do like Nigeria in Africa's laws of driving? Of course, it's going to be the Australian, because that's by which you abide and that's how you got your license. The same thing in Islam. Once you agree and you accept that the Quran comes from Allah, that's it. On Judgment Day, that will be your highway code to hellfire or paradise. Now, how did we err? How did we go far from the Quran? How has the Quran become so alienated today? So much so that if you're talking to Muslims in a regular conversation and they tell you, oh, it is Sunnah to do that, if you tell them, has Allah said something about that in the Quran, they will get touchy, they will get angry, and they point at you and accuse you. Right on. So today when you ask for an evidence from the Quran, you're faced with attacks. People start looking down on you. And actually, and it's been told to me that I am not a Muslim anymore. Why? Because I only believe in the Quran. So what has happened? What has happened to the Muslims? I will tell you right now what has happened to the Muslims so that you understand why Ad-Dajjal, why all those signs of the hour, why all those futuristics, why 99.9999, actually I would say 100% of what is hadith today has no relationship whatsoever with the Islam, and that the Quran is the only 100% authority. But I will give you an example so that you understand that. There are two men who changed the course of Allah's religion. One in Christianity and the other one in our Islam. The first one is known as Paul, or the Saint Paul, or the Paul the Apostle. And you've heard this in Christianity, Paul. But if you haven't heard from him, well, Christians today, or at least the Catholics and few other small denominations, follow exactly what Paul has written, what he has done. Paul, prior to his conversion to Christianity, was involved in persecuting the church. And this fact is clearly affirmed in the Bible itself. You can find it in the book of Acts in chapters 8, 9, 22, and 26. And he has written letters by himself. For example, in the book of the Corinthians in number 15, and the Galatians in the first book, and the Philippians. So he's written books about how he used to be a bad person persecuting the church. And it is a well-known fact in the Christian religion that what Paul did actually did change the Christian church forever. One day Paul wrote in his own letters in the Bible. So what Paul wrote to other people is part now of the Bible. And they tell you the Bible is a book revealed by Allah. But you find what Paul has done. I will come back to this point in a bit. But anyhow, what he said in there, he said that I have for... this is Paul talking. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. And that's it. That's what he says. And this is in Corinthians, the first Corinthians, and that is in chapter 15, verse number 9. In another writing to the Galatians, he openly declares to them, you have heard, no doubt, of my early life in Judaism. I was violently persecuting the church of God and was trying to destroy it. So how did this man change from being a sworn enemy to the church, become the man who will change the church altogether? And this is what you hear in one hour sheikhs talk and things like that. They will tell you Christianity was changed by a Jew. Well, guess what? Flash news. Christianity, the messenger Isa or Jesus was a Jew. And he was sent to the children of Israel. And there is nothing new about what Paul, the origins of Paul. But anyhow, so one day Paul was on a mission to capture some followers of the church of Jesus at that point there. Why he was persecuting, nobody knows for sure. And they have some assumptions and some theories, but we do not know exactly why he did that. And so when he wrote his letters, he didn't explain further because he was just writing it to people who knew what he did. He didn't know that his letters would be included part as the Bible as it stands today. So what has made Paul change? Well, as it goes, Paul is considered an apostle today in Christianity, even though he is not one of the 12 direct disciples of Jesus, of Isa alayhi salam. But you know, so he was the first, or let's put it like he was number 13. Right? Of course, his status as both Jew and a Roman citizen gave him the opportunity to preach his vision of the gospel and to give his thoughts and understanding some authority amongst people. So Paul told people back then of what had happened, by why he changed from who he was to what he was going to become. So he told them that one day while traveling the road from Jerusalem to Damascus on a mission to arrest the early Christians. Well, of course, the early Christians upheld that Jesus was just mere mortal and not the Son of God and things like that. And then his mission was to bring them back to Jerusalem where they'd be persecuted and executed. And then he said, when suddenly the resurrected Jesus appeared to him. So what we have here, Paul going and suddenly he sees Jesus appearing to him in a great light. Paul was struck blind by that light. But after 3 days, after he lost his sight, that sight that he lost was restored by Ananias. Well, this name of the apostle of Jesus, Ananias, is read in different versions. But he was one of the direct disciples of Jesus. So this man healed Paul. And that is the message from Paul that he would be a chosen one to preach because Jesus appeared to him personally. And then Paul began to preach that Jesus of Nazareth is the Jewish Messiah and also is the Son of God. And you find this in the book of Acts in chapter 9, and it's throughout the Bible. Now, needless to say that approximately half of the book of Acts deals with Paul's life and works. Basically, the Bible, which is supposed to be the holy word of God, has been added to with the biography of Paul, and everything is fine. As a matter of fact, the Bible has 27 books in it. 13 of these books have traditionally been attributed to Paul. That's almost half of the Bible by the hands of Mr. Paul. So if you ran a search about the Saint Paul, you'd be presented with some data about this essential personality in Christianity. And they will also tell you a lot of things about Paul. And that is how Christianity got changed to the way it is today. So if you go now to the church, to the Pope, to anyone, and you try to convince them that the Bible is not the holy words of Allah, that Paul has added to it, that the Christians aren't following what they should have been following, that the Bible doesn't say that Jesus is Son of God, that. It is also worth mentioning that Paul is the guy that has canceled all acts of rituals in the Bible. The Christians should have prayed like the Jews and like us. Who canceled that? Paul. How did he do that? Because of his vision. And the idea of I've seen a vision will also be spread to our world. So many great people today, like al-Bukhari, his entire life is based on somebody else seeing a vision. So we don't have a concrete, tangible fact to rely on except, oh, that a big sheikh saw in his dream that the messenger told him, you should abandon all books and just read Sahih al-Bukhari, which is a lie. But that lie, go now and tell al-Azhar or tell the Salafi Saudis or the Wahhabis that this is wrong and they will kill you for that. They will even call you a kafir. Now back to Christianity. So Paul changed the course of Christianity altogether. Now, who has changed the course of Al-Islam? Who is behind what we are on today? I will tell you who did that. And why, actually, also as well. One day, there was a king in the second dynasty of the Abbasi state. As you know, after the death of the Messenger of Allah came Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, and then everything went into a civil war, and then Muawiyah became the king. And with him, he started the Umayyad dynasty, which lasted about 112 years, give and take a few months here and there. And then came the second dynasty of the Abbasid dynasty, who lasted for over 6 centuries. And that is in this second dynasty that these events took place. And I always refer to as the third century. As it happens, Harun al-Rashid was the king. Of course, they wouldn't call him the king. They had to give him some religious garment to cover his deeds. So they used to call him Amir al-Mu'mineen or the Khalifa. Right, just like today in Saudi Arabia, any king is called the Khadim al-Haramain al-Sharifain, the subservient or the caretaker of the two holy shrines. So that's a religious garment that they throw on the king of Saudi Arabia so that we accept whatever they do. But this is politics for you. But anyhow, so Harun al-Rashid had big problems in his state. At that moment there, al-Mu'tazila. Al-Mu'tazila are people... If I was at that time there, they would consider me as a Mu'tazila, even though I am not. But just because you prioritize the Quran and you rule and you judge on everything else through the Quran, that's one part of the Mu'tazila. So they used to be extremely clever in the arguments. One day Harun al-Rashid had a problem with these people and his throne was at a danger. And there were small dissidents here and there, some rebellions here and there, revolts here and there. So one day, Harun al-Rashid was brought a bunch of people, about 9 or 10 of them, or less than that, and of the Mu'tazila, and he wanted to kill them. But he was given something, that there was a man amongst this bunch of people that was extremely good, very eloquent, very intelligent, and extremely, persuading. He persuades people with these arguments. And so he took interest. Of course, the rest of the people got executed, but that man was not executed. So he brought him and had an argument, not an argument, but a small chit-chat with him. And Harun al-Rashid straight away realized that this man was extremely eloquent and powerful in the words that he was presented. So Harun al-Rashid gradually started working on this guy. Now, Harun al-Rashid was born in 150 Hijri calendar, or 149, so to speak. Is that right? That is 1 year before the great man who would drive us against a wall, who would change the course of Islam forever. Because the people will stay on this kind of Islam until the end of time. And you and me, by putting the Quran, by rejecting what this man has brought to us, we will stand out from the crowd. But on Judgment Day, we will be winners because we've done everything we could to prioritize Al-Quran and not becoming a sheep just following along with what the other people did. However, so Harun al-Rashid talks to this man, realizes that this man has potential, that actually with his thinking process, if we could just alter it a little bit, if you could change the way he thinks and then use this man as a promoter of a new ideology, we will get rid of al-Mu'tazila. Now, that happened. And that man is al-Shafi'i. This al-Shafi'i, he's the starter, so to speak, of the third school of thought. You've got the Abu Hanifa, you've got Malik, and then you've got al-Shafi'i, and then comes after him Ahmed ibn Hanbal. Al-Shafi'i was born in Gaza, Palestine, in 150 years after the death of the messenger. And he died in year 204, the beginning of the third century, and he died in Egypt. And al-Shafi'i, whenever you hear scholars speaking about al-Shafi'i, they will always tell you there are two versions of al-Shafi'i. There was the first version when he was not in Egypt, and then when he went to Egypt, he changed his vision, his version, all the way 180 degrees. I.e., before Egypt, he was going one way left, and then he changed completely to going right. Yet, scholars don't talk about what was Shafi'i following before he changed his vision and his version. But if we study how he became, then we will know how he wasn't. And that's all there is to it. And by studying the life of a Shafi'i, how it is, how he pushed a Sunnah and how he did the Hadith and how he designed and did this, we realize that a Shafi'i was a Mu'tazila. And then he changed the course of his life to becoming a Sunni, so to speak. A Shafi'i, my dear sisters and my brothers, is unanimously agreed upon as the founder of the essential rules of the Islamic jurisprudence. In Arabic, هو مؤسس علوم أصول الفقه أو علم أصول الفقه. It is this man who said that revelation from Allah is the Quran and the Sunnah. It is him who started this idea that it's like saying to us that the revelation from Allah is a coin. On one side, the Quran, on the other side of the coin is the Sunnah. It is a Shafi'i who laid down the foundation of the Hadith, if I could call it science, because it's not a science, it's a matter of choices. Ahmed ibn Hanbal praised al-Shafi'i to the extent where he said, al-Shafi'i is like the sun for the world and is like wellness for people. And this is extremely dangerous statements, because they are used today. The moment you say al-Shafi'i, you'll be presented with, who are you to talk about al-Shafi'i when the great scholars have said this, and they bring countless praises about al-Shafi'i. They just forget one praise, the Quran. And to give al-Shafi'i a status that no one else can have, because you see, when he founded the rules of the essential, you know the essential rules of the Islamic jurisprudence? I'll give you an example. When you make your wudu, have you heard that you cannot do your wudu more than 3 times? If you do your wudu more than 3 times, it's haram and things like that. Well, it's Mr. Shafi'i who laid that down. And this is just one. A Shafi'i is the man who said that if a man fornicates with another woman and they are not married and a girl is born out of that fornication, a Shafi'i said that the father can marry his that girl because she is not his daughter, because they were not married. Yes, that's incest for you and me, but for a Shafi'i, the school of thought, he doesn't care. And he's got tons upon tons upon tons of those rules. Okay, I'm just being nice here. But anyhow, so to give a Shafi'i the status they wanted him to have, to control and to praise and put a Shafi'i at very, very high status, the untouchable status, even today, when I listen to YouTube, and as I told you, I consume a lot of researches and I listen to a lot of things. So many different people in Egypt and everything, they say, when a Shafi'i says something, and we think is wrong. What a Shafi'i said is not wrong, but we should just accuse our understandings. It's us who do not understand, not him who gets it wrong. The same thing was said about al-Bukhari, about Muslim, about Ibn Taymiyyah, about. So when these people make an error, it's not them, it's us. But that's the control. I will tell you why it has happened. So a Shafi'i, to give him that high status, what did they say? They say he is from Quraysh, and he is the only founder of the school of thought that is from Quraysh. And even so, back in the time of Harun al-Rashid, they invented a hadith that gave authority to Shafi'i like you would never ever believe that. For example, there is a hadith that says, do not insult Quraysh, because a scholar from Quraysh shall fill the earth with knowledge, i.e. a Shafi'i. Nowadays, they say the hadith is weak and it's not this and it's not that. But back in time, they didn't have that knowledge. Back in time, when they say Rasulullah said, it was to them like, yes, he said it and it's authentic and who cares about the rest. And even though, again, this hadith today is rejected, but I still heard many sheikhs mention it on the television. So my dear sisters and my brothers, a Shafi'i is the man who has injected that the revelation from Allah is not only the Quran as the Mu'tazila and as al-Shafi'i himself believed with that. But Harun al-Rashid had requested al-Shafi'i to find a way out on how he can counterbalance what al-Mu'tazila say. Because every time Harun al-Rashid says it, they say Allah. Al-Mu'tazila found one of their school of thought on one of the biggest great elements that Allah loves, and that is al-Adl, justice, which is absent in Islam. We do not have justice in Islam. Al-Shafi'i, before becoming the Sunni that he was, he used to believe in justice. He was a revolter. He was an arrogant person. He used to fight and all that kind of stuff. And then when he became a friend of Harun al-Rashid, Harun al-Rashid told him, help me. Because Harun al-Rashid was not just by any stretch of imagination, nothing. That's why he was killed. Harun al-Rashid, that's why he's so controversial today. His personality, they will tell you Harun al-Rashid was a man with fun, women dancing, and the other was, no. He used to be a mujahid, and he used to be a preacher, blah, blah, blah. The reason that is because Harun al-Rashid behaved in some way. People realized about him, wrote about him, but his historians, the people that worked for Harun al-Rashid, wrote good stuff about him. That's why we have conflicting information about this guy. And al-Shafi'i came at the rescue of who? Of the fifth Abbasi king, Harun al-Rashid, who I said was born in 149. Notice, al-Shafi'i was born in 150. Harun al-Rashid, 149. So they were close in age. So when you are close in age, you can befriend somebody pretty much soon. So it's not like that. And even though al-Shafi'i died when he was 54, Harun al-Rashid was assassinated and killed when he was 44 years of age. So he outlived Harun al-Rashid to actually witness the crowning of the kid of Harun al-Rashid, al-Amin, who was only 5 years of age. And al-Amin was a skirt chaser. He was more into drinks and parties and women and slaves, girls, and all that kind of stuff. He didn't last longer. And guess who came? Came al-Ma'mun. And al-Ma'mun had of his teachers of the Mu'tazila. So al-Ma'mun was extremely very enamored, very in love with the Mu'tazila school of thought. But by the time al-Ma'mun came, al-Shafi'i had already helped his dad, or the head of the dad of al-Ma'mun, Harun al-Rashid, with the Sunnah being part of the Wahi. And then the whole battle at that time there started all over again, where the Mu'tazila wanted to gain that the Quran is the sole authority, and the Sunni or the Salafi or the Ahl Sunnah people wanted to prove that nope, the Wahi, the revelation from Allah, is two sides of a coin, the Quran and the Sunnah. And this is extremely dangerous. My dear sisters, when you say the Quran, not then the Sunnah, it is the Quran and the Sunnah. This is why today they play with the Quran to no end. You tell them this, they say, no, this one has been abrogated. No, Allah didn't mean that. They play with the Quran far worse than the Christians played with the Bible. What Paul did for Christianity, al-Shafi'i did worse than that for Islam. And as I said, my dear sisters and my brothers, today the hadith that we have today, the foundations of this science, if I can call it science, because it's not. That's why you have al-Bukhari, who bring in a book. Muslim, who is the student of al-Bukhari for over 15 years, doesn't agree with the rules by which al-Bukhari collected his hadith and the conditions. And then Muslim goes and collects hadith from his own way. Then comes Abu Dawood in the same. All this is within the 50-year circus. So it's not like one of them came today and the other one 3 centuries later. No, they all existed like almost 50 years away from each other. So then comes Ibn Dawood, and he will collect hadith in his own way. At-Tirmidhi will do it, An-Nasa'i will do it, Ibn Majah will do it, Al-Bazzar will do it. Each one of them collects the hadith according to his own, what he sees makes the hadith authentic. There is no rules that runs what hadith is honest, true, correct, weak, or whatever. It's only later on that the mechanics of the hadith, the sheikhs, tried to figure out some rules to show people that the hadith should stay like this. But as a matter of fact, no. If a sheikh today, Al-Albani, when Al-Albani came, he just came out of his own mind. What he decides is an authentic hadith becomes an authentic hadith. What he decides is not an authentic hadith is not an authentic hadith. That's end of it. You cannot argue with any sheikh of the hadith. And that's one of huge problems. Now, another thing, my dear sisters, back to Harun al-Rashid and al-Shafi'i. Historians have tried to study the life of a Shafi'i that has been hidden from the masses because Harun al-Rashid and then the Salafi propaganda machine after that wanted to separate a Shafi'i from his first version when he was in Gaza and Yemen before Egypt. But subhanAllah, no matter how hard you hide, even a Shafi'i himself wrote about himself in some of his writings, and few other scholars that lived near him and they were of his school of thought wrote about him. They say that al-Shafi'i received his knowledge from two of the most prominent scholars in the Mu'tazila school of thought in his time. First of them is Sheikh Ibrahim ibn Yahya. And even though this sheikh was vilified by our scholars, the Sunni scholars, he remains a teacher to al-Shafi'i. And al-Shafi'i narrated hadith from this man, and this man is considered a good man when it comes to hadith. But that is what it is. The second sheikh, his name is Muslim ibn Khalid al-Zinji, i.e. Muslim ibn Khalid the Black. And he was a mufti in Mecca at the time of the Abbasid dynasty, Harun al-Rashid and so on and so forth, right? And again, because they wanted to lock down this sheikh, because he is a teacher, direct teacher of a Shafi'i, they disagreed about this sheikh. Some of our scholars of the hadith say he's a great man. Others say, no, he's a villain, he's an evil person. But again, he remains a teacher of a Shafi'i nonetheless. All biographies about a Shafi'i reported that a Shafi'i used to read some Quran the way the Mu'tazila read it. And I'll give you just one example because I don't want this to go for a long time. For example, Allah says in the Quran, قَالَ عَذَابِ أُصِيبُ بِهِ مَنْ أَشَاءُ. My torment, I afflict with it whomever I wish. So this is in Surah Al-A'raf and the ayah is 156. But Imam Fakhr al-Razi mentioned in his book about Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, the good manners of al-Shafi'i and his knowledge, that he said that al-Shafi'i used to read this ayah as the Mu'tazila read it. قَالَ عَذَابِ أُصِيبُ بِهِ مَنْ أَسَاءُ. My torment, I afflict with it whomever does wrong or whoever goes wrong. My dear sisters and my brother, it's worth saying that this recitation exists today among some scholars, even though our scholars do their best to refute it and reject it. So as I said, al-Shafi'i, under the commands of and orders, direct orders of his friend Harun al-Rashid, was deputized to design a methodology to fight back his old school of thoughts, the Mu'tazila. And again, the Mu'tazila were against the tyranny and oppression of Harun al-Rashid and the kings before him. And they were against making the throne an inheriting matter, like Saudi Arabia, this king inherits the other one, and so on and so forth. Okay? And a long story short, al-Shafi'i did just that. It was him, al-Shafi'i, who out of his own mind wrote the rules by which the Islamic jurisprudence must run. It is al-Shafi'i who wrote everything to support the king Harun al-Rashid and his vision and ideologies. And because of this, al-Shafi'i's work got all the praises by every scholar in his time. And all this because the king wants it. Look at Saudi Arabia today. Anyone who is pro-government, pro-royal family is alive, gets money, gets fame, gets everything. You open your mouth a little bit and you are completely thrown out. And just recently, a couple of days ago, there is a well-known sheikh called Salih al-Maghamsi. The Arab world knows this sheikh. He is so pro-Saudi government that you would think he is the shoe shiner of the crown prince. Recently, he just wrote one tweet. He tweeted one message. And he said, in these hard times where there is the coronavirus, three things would help us evade the punishment of Allah. First of all is that we turn to Allah in forgiveness and repentance. But the third point is what interests us here is that, and he said, the release from jail whenever it's possible of the prisoners. And that's it. Right on. He wrote it now. Not an hour after that came his demise. They completely removed him from being the imam of Masjid Qiba. He is no longer the man who gives khutbah there or lessons. Another sheikh was appointed. And this man now is in danger of going to jail. Why? Because he just made one small dua to release the prisoners. And then he wrote, he tweeted later on, I didn't mean the political prisoners. I am 100% behind the crown prince. Whatever he does is good for our country. If these people are vile and bad and evil, let them rot in jail. And he says this about scholars like him and sheikhs like him. But why does he say that? Because he is a pro-king. And then the sheikh who came, who was appointed in his place, tweeted right on and there, I thank the crown prince, our rulers, our waliil amr, our kings, our politicians who see the good for this country. I am 100% behind them. I will support them in the hidden, in the open. And he went and tweeted to shoe shine, not only their shoes, but maybe they even they spit in. So if what you see in Saudi Arabia today, and if you are not in politics today, you will never ever discover what has happened to our beautiful Islam, how it was hijacked. A Shafi'i is the father of all problems that we are facing today. Why am I telling you all this? Because if a Shafi'i didn't stick his nose in this, if a Shafi'i did not change the religion of Allah, if a Shafi'i has not injected this pure poison in Al-Quran, he did that in a small, tiny book that is around 100 pages. It's called Ar-Risala, The Message. A small manuscript, about 100 pages, really. And of course, there are countless versions of this manuscript. Each one of them has different wordings. And you would... just recently I started reading a book about this Risala. It has 556 pages from a Saudi sheikh who was explaining what a Shafi'i meant. Imagine, and in that book, he would tell you on page one, a Shafi'i said this, but on another version, it says that, on the third version, it says that, on the fourth version, it says that, on the fifth version, it says that, on the seventh version, on the ninth version, so many different versions. And sometimes the difference is really scary. It is this man who has designed the essential rules of the Islamic jurisprudence. So if women are cursed, it's because of Shafi'i. If women are put so down, it is because of him. He started this whole thing. And it is a Shafi'i who also wrote the essential rules of the hadith science. And then later on, Al-Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, and all these people came after that and started working on what a Shafi'i had already decided. And because Harun al-Rashid and his government were pro-Shafi'i, were after a Shafi'i, were supporting of a Shafi'i, because what a Shafi'i did and said helps King Harun al-Rashid to stay in power so that the dynasty goes on. So it was a win-win situation, exactly like Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab did with the King Muhammad ibn Saud, the Saudi. And the alliance goes on in Saudi Arabia today. People are dancing naked in Mecca, and the Sheikh, the Wahhabi Sheikhs, do not talk. It no longer is haram. When they needed Islam, they worked with Islam. And that's what happened in the 70s, 80s, 90s, when America wanted Muslims to go fight in Afghanistan, the Wahhabi machine and the, oh God. So a Shafi'i is behind all this. So the Islam, and I will say this with the deepest regret, with the deepest sadness, that the Islam that is followed today is not an Islam built around the Quran, but is an Islam built around what a Shafi'i wants. twisted. Even the ayat that where Allah talks about something, they twisted the meaning to mean what a Shafi'i said because that's what he said. Now, my dear sisters and my brothers, go and do your very best to convince the Christian church that Paul has done wrong and see how many will believe you. The same thing, same wise, go to the Islamic church, to us Muslims today, and tell them what a Shafi'i has done wrong to our Islam and see how many will believe you. Allah says in the Quran that Hajj is done within months. Al-Hajj ashhur al-ma'lumat. But Mr. Shafi'i and the kings of the past decides that Hajj takes place in 5 days. So today we have abandoned the months of Hajj and we stuck to the 5 days. If this is what we have done with Hajj, I will tell you we've done worse with as-salat, with fasting and all that. Now that you understand, my dear sisters and my brothers, why the Quran has been kept away and who is the responsible behind this, and all the topics like the Mahdi and the Dajjal and the curse of women, stories about what's going to happen on Judgment Day, punishment in the grave, etc., they do not have a place in Allah's Quran and are only in a Shafi'i school of thoughts that has been since the past planted, and nowadays we have an endless variety of these things. Again, why am I telling you this? Because when we study at Dajjal and any subsequent talks after that, or all my talks before this, you know where I am coming from. All I am doing is putting the Quran back on the driving seat. On Judgment Day, if Allah didn't say something in the Quran, I am in total ease not doing it. Because on Judgment Day, if Allah tells me, why didn't you do that, or why did you do that, all I gotta say is, ya Allah, you didn't say it in the Quran, or you said it in the Quran, and you would win the argument. I pray to Allah this is very clear to you. I will stop here. It's 40 minutes in this part here, but this is a necessity, a very much needed topic. Now that you understand where our problems come from, let us go back to Ad-Dajjal. And I want to say about the woman who reported the hadith in Muslim. Because my dear sisters and my brothers, you have to understand one point. A hadith, an event like Ad-Dajjal, is such a huge topic today in 2020. We are faced with this coronavirus. People are talking about it every single day. You talk about it to your family, to your friends, to whoever cares to listen, because it threatens our lives. But because of such an extremely important matter as Ad-Dajjal, and for such an extremely fate-decisive matter, where people who would believe in Ad-Dajjal will spend their lives for eternity in hellfire, and this incredible divine test, only one woman remembers this hadith, Fatima bint Qais. And they tell us the companions had incredible memorization capacities. What happened to the entire masjid audience when the messenger told this story? What happened to all the companions, Ali, Abu Bakr, Umar, Ibn Abbas, Ibn Mas'ud, Aisha, who had her house very near to where the messenger used to give his khutbas? This woman, Fatima bint Qais, a companion, tells this hadith, and she singles out one person called Amir ibn Sharahil al-Shabi. And he is a follower. And here is the big problem, my dear sisters and my brothers. They do not tell you this. This man, Amir ibn Sharahil, the follower, the Tabi'i, was born 21 years after the death of the messenger. I want you to just concentrate on this, yeah? The messenger is dead. Then this man is born 21 years after his death. And then, let's take a minute, my sister and my brother, to examine this madness. It really is a madness. I want you to take a minute, I think. 21 years since the death of the messenger, this young man, Amir, was born. Then add another, say, 20 years for him to grow and become a knowledgeable person, seek knowledge and things like that. Right? So, If you did the math, he'll be like in his 40s, or maybe, well, let's say he's in 30s, whatever, right? So this man is to have reported this hadith to us in Muslim, who is a student al-Bukhari, but al-Bukhari completely ignored this hadith. So why? Why would a woman shut her mouth in such a big, huge problem for 21 years? And then the boy is born, and then let's give him 15 years. Okay, I'm going to 15 years, and he's a genius already. He that's 36 years since the death of the messenger, and he goes to her, asks her, tell me a hadith. You haven't heard it from somebody else. 36 years later, she tells him that I would spend my entire life warning people because of that. The entire Muslim community in Al-Madinah would be talking about Ad-Dajjal. Such huge event. And the messenger, they tell you another hadith, has warned us countless times. There is not a single prophet or messenger that came in the past that hadn't warned his people. And then this person, this woman, would tell this hadith to a single man around 36 years later. And they want me to believe this? No, I'm really sorry. I do not believe this. My dear sisters, I want to give you a couple of facts about this overpraised, almost reaching saint of this Shafi'i and what he has this, okay? Imam Muslim, just to give you an idea about that era, so that you have an idea of what took place in that time, okay? Muslim, Imam Muslim that we all know, was born in Iran in year 206. I'm going to talk Hijri calendar. And this is again at the beginning of the 3rd century. So he's not far off from a Shafi'i who died in year 204. Al-Bukhari was born in 194. Again, Muslim 206, Al-Bukhari 194. So both of them very close to the 3rd century. A Shafi'i had already provided the platform for hadith for them. All they had to do is when they start collecting the hadith, they start acting on what the Shafi'i did, and then they build on that. Abu Dawood, I'm sure you've heard this name, when they say Abu Dawood said this in his Sunnah, was born in the year 133 and died in year 204, again, 3rd century. At-Tirmidhi, he was born in 209 and died 279. So he lived through the 3rd century. And he was born in Uzbekistan and died in Uzbekistan, but he did go to Iraq and Arabic and all that kind of stuff. An-Nasa'i was born in 133 in Uzbekistan. Again, Uzbekistan is right behind Iran. And he died 204, killed in Palestine because they wanted him to insult Ali and he didn't want to do it. So they killed him because of that. Ibn Majah was born in the year 209 and died 273 in Iran. Ahmed ibn Hanbal, who is the founder of the Hanbali school of thought, when Ahmed ibn Hanbal did, he did not consider his thinking was a school of thought. He was more of a scholar of hadith rather than a faqih. But it's later on that his followers decided to make him a school of thought. But anyhow, so Ahmed ibn Hanbal was born in the year 164 in Iraq and died 241 in Al-Iraq. All of the above and the huge majority of those called scholars of hadith were all people who existed more than 130 years. I'm taking here the youngest. Abu Dawud was born in 133 and An-Nasa'i 133. Okay, other people 150 to 100, things like that. After the death of the Messenger of Allah. And there were countless civil wars from the death of Rasulullah until the 3rd century. There were revolts, plots, killings, assassinations, poisoning, all kinds of things. The period of unrest is incredible. Therefore, between the time they collected the hadith from the last mouth who told it to them and they put it on paper, and the first man who heard it from Rasulullah, there are between 3 to 9 generations. 3 to 9 generations, because you're talking 200 years. But you know what? I don't believe the 3 counting. And because they say this is al-Bukhari, and I believe it's a lie. And here is why. In 1861, if my memory serves me well, a civil war broke in America. You know, the north part, the Yankees against the people from the south. And it ended in 1865. So that is 4 years, five if you want to include the years. But anyhow, so let's say it's 4 years of the battle. At the end, in 1865, General Lee of the Confederate States, i.e. the Southern States, gave a sermon, a khutbah, a speech. There were, let's say, 300 soldiers. What I want you to do now is I want you to trace back his sermon and find out what he said. So all you have to do now is find someone who heard the sermon from somebody else who heard it from somebody else who heard it from somebody else who heard it from somebody else until you go to General Lee. But this is impossible to do. And that's exactly for the hadith. The hadith was collected. So Al-Bukhari finds someone, hears the hadith from him, and then he's going to tell him, who did you hear it from? So the narrator will tell him who he heard it from. So if I wanted to lie, I can say a hadith, and I know at that time there who is reliable, who is not reliable, and I will just collect, just will say, stick the hadith on someone who is reliable. And then who, because the other person is dead. How are we going to know who he heard it from? You see what I mean? The impossibility is there. But they want you to not question the hadith and not know about it and all that, so that you don't end up putting them, pinning them against the wall. So if you want the sheikhs of today to trace back an event that took 300 years ago, we want to see how far any sheikh can go. I can guarantee you nowhere. And that's that. So for Al-Bukhari, who is born in year 194, and then we're going to give it like 15 years, okay? So he started in year 210 for 14 years, yeah? And then he traces back a hadith that has gone between him and the Messenger of Allah. 210 years with civil war, killings, assassination, and things like that. And then you come and tell me that Al-Bukhari brings a hadith authentic. The other thing, my dear sister and my brother, the hadith that this Fatima bint Qais has narrated is an ahad. It's a singular form. One woman hears it out by herself, then tells it to another man after almost 36 years have gone by. So this woman has kept her mouth shut and didn't alarm the people around her who lived in her time, didn't tell it to her children, didn't tell it to her husband, didn't tell it to her neighbors, didn't tell anybody about this huge catastrophe that's going to befall humanity. And knowing that Ad-Dajjal could come out at any day, any time since the death of the messenger, and she still kept her mouth shut. What kind of a trustworthy and honorable companion was she? How could an event like this escape the mind of a companion woman whom the scholars insist that she was an honorable and trustworthy companion? No human, my dear sisters and my brothers, worth a grain of salt would forget a dangerous creature like Ad-Dajjal. Can we today expect the BBC not to talk about the coronavirus? A killer. And then they claim that the matter of Ad-Dajjal, they heard it from the mouth of the messenger. And bear this, our scholars insist that the messenger has warned his companions over and over and over and over, so much so that the companions got scared that Ad-Dajjal would come out from just behind the trees. And then this woman would shut her mouth for a staggering 36 years until someone comes and asks her. My dear sisters and my brothers, this particular event and the story told behind it should have been spread around like hot cake. But only one single woman heard it, memorized it, and then told it to another single man some 36 years ago or 40 years later, and then they expect us to accept it. Ad-Dajjal, my dear sisters, represents the evil. He is the head of evil. Yet Allah, who is just and merciful, latifun bil ibad, and is very caring for us, would let the head of evil, Ad-Dajjal, thrive, and he would let him live for centuries. But the carriers of goodness and greatness and piety, i.e. the messengers, die? What kind of divine logic is this? Why should a Dajjal keep living until the end of time, knowing the evil that he is? And why shouldn't Allah, why didn't Allah leave the messengers live until the end of time? They would admonish us, they would still keep receiving the revelation, and we'd be all good and nice, right? But that is thinking that there is no logic in this Ad-Dajjal issue altogether. Ad-Dajjal not only was alive at the time of the messenger, but he also was alive long before then because the Christians saw him. He was alive when At-Tamim Ad-Dari saw him and spoke with him. So what's even more insulting to our messenger is that Tamim, the Christian man, knew of Ad-Dajjal before even the messenger heard about him. Because the Christian man came by the time the messenger had migrated to Al-Madina, let's say he has 15 years, and this Tamim Ad-Dari didn't say last month, he said one day. So it's a long story about that. So the Tamim Ad-Dari knew about the Dajjal, and Rasulullah was in Mecca talking to people, had no clue whatsoever about this great danger. What if a Dajjal appeared that the messenger was in Mecca? How would he react then? Wallahi, a normal man would just reject the whole thing. But to us, we gotta expect, they expect us to believe in this and make it part of our Islam. And when you reject it, you become a kafir. Is this the religion that Allah has sent? Is it for this that Allah has sent the messengers and the Quran and all this? Absolutely not. And one last point before I go, and inshallah in the next upcoming talk I will speak about the beast that's gonna come at the end of time. But I wanna say this. If this island where Ad-Dajjal has existed ever exist, where is it now? So if this island where Ad-Dajjal lives now existed, where is it? We've got, look my dear, imagine an angry sea throws you around mercilessly. And because you came home, so 30 days, continuous nights and days, okay. Till you have no clue whatsoever where you are, and then by some miraculous quirks of fate, you end up near some isolated island. And not only an isolated island, but an island that is imprisoning the biggest, most dangerous, and the deadliest human that will ever face humanity. And that Allah will use that human to unleash him on humanity. Then once Tamim and his friends left this mysterious island, some kind of a veil is thrown on it. And with all the technology advancement and everything to save our lives and skins, we cannot trace this island. No Google, nothing. Go figure. This is why I told you about Paul and what he did to Christianity, Ash-Shafi'i, and what he did to our Islam. Because from now on, when we speak about the hadith and things like that, you have a good founding element. Believe me, my sisters and my brothers, the majority of what they call themselves Salafis have no clue about this, what Ash-Shafi'i has done. Their sheikhs, they know, but they cannot speak because their livelihood is based on what they preach to people, exactly like the Christian priests. You go to a church, the church is employed by Rome or by whatever denomination is running that church. The priest can only preach to people what the church approves. The same thing in Egypt, Al-Azhar. Al-Azhar produces sheikhs like the chicken produces eggs. I call them the mass-produced sheikhs. MPS, mass-produced sheikhs. Saudi Arabia, the same thing. They produce massively. It's just like students of medicine. The university just produces them, right? But as long as these sheikhs stick to what Al-Azhar, the politics of Al-Azhar, they'll be fine. These days, the president of Egypt, Assisi, kills people day and night, imprisons them, mistreats them. He's a tyrant, so much so that Trump called him my favorite tyrant. Al-Azhar is behind him. You know what they did these days in this coronavirus pandemic? Assisi recorded with his own voice a dua that he makes. And this dua is played on television after the adhan. Who supports this dua? Al-Azhar. Who uploaded this dua? The sheikhs from Al-Azhar. A tyrant, an assassin, a killer becomes a prophet in our times. This is what for the last 1400 years politics have made of our Islam. If you open today your mouth and you put Al-Quran, because Al-Quran came to set us free, the Hadith came to set us slaves. And this is the difference between the two. If a Shafi'i didn't put his nose where he shouldn't have, if he didn't write what he should not have, if the sheikhs of the past didn't work for the government, if they didn't lie, if they did not isolate the Quran, we would be talking today about other more beautiful and more pressing topics. But because they messed it up in the past and they're still messing it up today, we find ourselves talking about a Dajjal. Wallahi, it's shame on us. On Judgment Day, Allah is going to tell us, I spoke about the ant and the bee. I spoke about the elephant. I spoke about little tiny flies. And I wouldn't speak about Ad-Dajjal. What's wrong with you? But what's wrong with us is the programmation of a Shafi'i to our mind. Next week, inshallah, or the next talk, bi'inillah, I will start with the beast that will come and will talk to us, as Allah says in Al-Quran, وَإِذَا وَقَعَ الْقَوْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ, and when the decree of the hour comes to pass against them, أَخْرَجْنَا لَهُمْ دَابَّةً مِنَ الْأَرْضِ, we shall bring forth for them a beast from the earth, تُكَلِّمُهُمْ إِنَّ النَّاسَ كَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا لَا يُوقِنُونَ. And I will explain this ayah and where it comes from and why it's here and what, and that kind of stuff. Until my next talk, my dear brothers and my sisters, stay in the mercy of Allah. Use your mind. Do not buy stories just like that. Even what I told you today, you go, okay, Shafi'i did that. Go research. Yes, it's in Arabic and they will not translate this in English, and that's the sad thing, right? But if you find something in Arabic, give it to any Arab. Tell him, read this. Read. Can you read what the Shafi'i did? What mess he got us into? What kind of deep holes he dug for us? And why? And then you start understanding that for the last 1400 years, we have been victims to politics manipulating Islam exactly like Christianity did, Judaism did, and every other people did. The Quran is our only way out. And I intend to preach in this until the day I meet Allah. This is again your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa, and until my next talk, please be and stay in the mercy of Allah. Do everything you can to put yourself not at the mercy of the coronavirus, and do everything that you can to safeguard yourself, your loved ones, and everyone, loved ones, humanity as a whole, against this great virus, and take every precautions. And when you do that, make dua to Allah to give you that extra oomph so that you get to that protection island, so that he helps you. And as I said in one of my things on Facebook, do not put yourself in the mouth of a coronavirus and then say this is a decree of Allah, just like you wouldn't put yourself in the mouth of a lion and then say this is a decree of Allah. That was your choice, and Allah is innocent from it. You have a wonderful day. You can check this talk, inshallah, on YouTube. It's Islam Pep Talk. If you want to join my group on WhatsApp, my number is 0787640-8735. And you have a beautiful, wonderful day. Until my next talk. Assalamu alaikum.